Hello, beautiful human. You clicked on our interview with Ollie Alexander. Years and Years, new album, Palo Santo. It is out July 6th, but it could be out right now. Phenomenal body of work. We're going to get into that. Sanctify and so much. This human being is a special one. He's awesome. Ollie, please leave your honest feedback in the comment section below. We have a podcast link in the description below. And if you could, it'd be awesome if you subscribed. Okay, enjoy.
Let's do this.
Yo.
Are we being interviewed?
Right now we are. We welcome to the studio, Ollie Alexander.
Yeah.
All right, all right.
Years and years.
The Zach Sang Show.
Dan, Heather, Zach, and Ollie Alexander.
Yes. But I want to get right into it because it's been 2 years since you've been here.
It has. I had blonde hair.
You did.
Yeah, and now my hair is red.
Yeah.
Where are we at now in life?
Next time I see you, my hair will be yellow. No, blue.
Yellow's kind of blonde already.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That's true.
Do you have that planned out? Do you know the stages of your hair and when you're going to do it?
I didn't, but now I think maybe every time I see you, I need to have a different hair color.
Pressure.
So,
good.
Yeah.
Show us a good time. Change it up. Dude, new album coming out very soon.
Yes.
Palo Santo.
Palo.
What? Palo Santo?
Palo, yeah.
I put a B in there, I'm sorry.
Pablo.
It's a Kanye mashup.
Palo Santo. Is there pressure? You release a track list in April, but the album doesn't drop until July.
Yes.
Like, how long has this album been finished?
It's been finished since April. but... I mean, most of the songs were kind of wrapped up at the end of last year, but, you know, finishing everything takes a while, so... Yes.
But like, that's a lot of buildup, no? Like, you put it out to the world, do people want to see it?
I know. Well, I also feel like, not that I've gotten married ever, but I feel a bit like the nerves that you get before your big day.
Yeah.
So the album is kind of like the big day, you know, because it's like my beautiful bride or something. Or I'm the bride and the album is my baby. Maybe it's a baby No, I'm confusing all my like metaphors now.
It's exciting.
It's very exciting.
There it is.
Yeah. It's very exciting.
This phase of music for you started with Sanctify, right? Like that was the first single to come off of this album.
Yes.
Why was that the right record to set the tone for everything else to follow?
Oh, well, I guess we wanted to go with Sanctify first because it felt like it was something that was very, it was quite different for us, and we wanted to come back with like a strong statement, you know, and Sanctify is like very much inspired by my love of like early 2000s pop, you know, like Britney, Slave For You era,
yeah.
And Christina and Justin Timberlake, Justified. And I think we just felt like it sounded really fresh. And
I agree with that.
Yeah,
but
you think it's fresh?
I think it's as fresh as fresh can be.
Zach Sang says it's fresh.
Rate
must
it.
Be fresh then.
Put it on the billboards. But your lyrics, like I don't want to say you're clouding the meaning of your lyrics by saying that like it's, you know, Christina Aguilera or Britney Spears style pop, because your lyrics have a lot of depth and a lot of meaning. And I read that you're really trying to send a message
yes.
with this album.
Yes. Well, I also love a song that kind of operates on both those levels, you know, like a yeah. song that can be feel quite surface and like you can just sing along and you don't think too much about the meaning. But then at the same time, it hits you with this like secret deep meaning if you want it to look a little deeper. So I really love that kind of balance in a pop song, which you do get, but it can be hard to kind of do. But that's what we try to do. Yeah.
So before you embark on this creative journey, right, to do any song, are you going in with the idea of this is the story I want to tell, and then if it becomes a poppy dance surface level hit, it happens? Like, what is the priority for you creatively?
I think it's to try and get the both things at the same time, because I am not interested in a song that I can't sing along to, you know. Yeah. Like, I love a pop song, it's got to have hooks, got to have a chorus. That's just me, you know. I'm kind of traditional-ish in terms of the pop music I like. But it means like within that you can mess around with the rules, you know. That's what makes it exciting when you listen to like a great pop song. You're like, oh wow, it sounds familiar, but it sounds a little different. And I'm like surprised by the rhythm, and then I want to sing along to this bit, and you know what I mean? So it's kind of, it's like almost like a little science-y formula, which I, you know, don't know the formula to, but yeah.
Is the formula takes a different shape every time you enter the studio?
Yeah, actually. Well, you have. I think we, for me personally, I try and be like as open-minded as possible because you never know. Sometimes you get really great songs from a way that you might not have been expecting. You know, like say. I mean, I write a lot of songs at the piano, so I'll just be playing some chords and then I'll like start humming a melody and then fit lyrics to the melody. But then sometimes, like, say you're working with a producer or someone who's got like a drum loop or like a synth sound that's really cool and that inspires you to write something different. So you try and be a little bit flexible, but open-mindedness
is obviously key. But there's a lot of songs on this album based on the track list that you wrote either just you or with one other person.
Yes.
Like, there's some that you kept really narrow. You controlled that room in that process.
Yes. I didn't expect you to pick up on that, but that's true. Yeah, a lot of it was just me or me and someone else. I don't know. I feel like, especially with this album, it was so important to me to have like everything so personal. You know, like I write personal music, but also, you know, I feel like as a songwriter, I just have been wanting to kind of get my voice out there, and I've wanted to write these songs for so long, and so I was like quite like, oh, I need to have my stamp on everything and I need to be involved with everything and every word, every melody, like, you know. So I got quite I think that's why the album is like, making it was sometimes quite challenging, because it was like I was just always so like, you know, in my head, I was just the detail of everything. I was like obsessed with it.
It's all you. It's all encompassing.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Yeah.
And
yeah.
Are you listening to the album still? And like, I mean, the time between April and release is a long time for you to sit with that body of work that you think is finished.
Yeah.
And then you listen to it and like, were you still picking things out that could be changed?
Not really. I think there's a couple of things where I think, oh, would I have done this? Would I do that again the same exact same way? Maybe not. But actually, I'm really happy with the album. Like, I still listen to it, you know, like every now and then. I love hearing it, you know, putting it on when I'm cleaning or I'm just when I'm in the shower, you know.
Best time to listen to music.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's also how you got discovered. Singing in the shower.
There we go. Coming through with that origin story. Yes, exactly.
Come on. So Sanctify, what I read, right, is there's a story here, and it's your interaction with heterosexual people who have certain views on homosexuality. Can you go and, like, from your own mouth, explain that and how that all connects?
Yeah, so Sanctify, basically, I wanted to write this song about something I had been experiencing, and it's something I've experienced multiple times throughout my life, right? And I'm an out gay guy. I've been out for, you know, nearly for about 10 years, say, and coming out is a really painful, it can be like a really painful experience, you know, because you have to come out to yourself and then you have to come out to your family, potentially, and then you have to come out to like your employers.
It's like a tour.
Right? It's like, and then it's constant for the rest of your life, you know, taxi drivers, you know, people that you meet at the store, whatever. And so I wanted to write a song that kind of spoke to that experience. And during that experience, I would meet guys who identified as straight, but would have like a romantic connection with me, and you know, they'd be different every time depending on the guy. Like, sometimes it wouldn't be romantic or sometimes it would be, and but we'd have a relationship, and I was really fascinated by what was happening in that moment, because, you know, I'm obviously an out gay guy, but I'm sort of investing something romantically into this guy that identifies as straight, and then the straight guy is maybe confused about his sexuality or doesn't want to admit that he might actually have some gay feelings, and that's happened to me a few times, you know, and it's quite a common experience for gay men to kind of have some kind of like encounters with straight dudes, and so yeah, that's a really long explanation. I apologize, but that's kind of what Sanctify is about. Yeah,
when you're giving your love to them, is that what you consider a sin?
So the line "sanctify my sins when I pray" is kind of like, it's like there's a few things like going on, because, you know, traditionally the church, you know, I use a lot of like religious imagery in my songs and stuff, and traditionally the church has shut out gay people, you know, so I kind of wanted to subvert that and talk about how, you know, like the Bible says, you know, homosexuality is a sin, but I'm saying that like, this is not sinful. This is a blessing, you know. Like, I'm gonna make my sins holy. That's what sanctify means, to make something holy. So yeah, that's kind of where that line comes from.
So when you want to write this record, like, how does this one in particular start? Like, do you just gather all these experiences and you go, in order for me to move on in life, I need to put it out some way. I need to, like, or was there, do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Was there, I'm just trying to phrase it. Like, do you just, like, get to, like, a breaking point with all these straight dudes that you're just giving your romantic energy and focus to?
Kind of, I think. Yeah. I mean, the process is quite mysterious because, say, you know, like, I'm writing a song a day, sometimes, like, over a period of however many weeks or months, like, so it's going through loads and loads and loads of songs, and then, I don't know, like, I'll realise that there's this one little thing that's been creeping into the lyrics, and I'm like, oh, maybe I want to write a song that's about that, you know? Maybe it's a song about this, and so, I don't know, the whole process kind of, like, changes, and so there's never really, like, one point where I'm like, ah, this is what the album's going to be, or this is what, you know, the rest of the song's going to be. You kind of just have to figure it out along the way, or that's what it's like for me, anyway.
So, like, you catch themes that come up while you're writing.
Yeah.
Got it. And then once maybe it's a recurring theme, that's when you tap into it and you expand on it.
That's right. Because I was finding that a lot of the songs for this album were about previous relationships, you know, and kind of reflecting on the, you know, what happened in, you know, with ex-boyfriends or whatever. And so, like, once I kind of realized that, the rest kind of followed a bit easier.
You know, this album obviously super personal, but the last time we talked was 2015 and you were in the cycle for communion.
Yes.
At what point do you start writing Palo Santo?
So started towards the end of 2016, started writing. Yeah.
So you're coming off that success and where, like, you were here in LA, you were touring, you were doing a lot, like, did you just, like, put yourself in a room and get it done, or were you just writing as you went?
Well, we finished touring towards the end of 2016, and then I actually came to LA for a couple of weeks and did kind of, like, shut myself away and do a bit of writing, like, straight after the touring, and then we took a break, and then we came back to everything in the beginning of 2017. But it just happened, like, it was a really long process, you know, so it's like, I wanted to try and get a head start, but actually all the writing took, like, it took almost a year even.
Wow.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know, it's weird because you just think, oh, it's only, you know, say a song is only like 3.5 minutes, like, how long can it be to make that? But
a long time.
It can be a long time.
But on this album, like we said before, there were songs that you wrote, just you and maybe one other person, but at the same time, you expanded your room, like who you would have in the room. You worked with Justin Tranter. You work with Julia Michaels on Hallelujah. Haven't heard that record. Would love to.
Aww.
On July 6th, I believe it comes out.
We'll send
out.
It to you, Zach. And it's out on the 6th.
Getting into the room with these two people, you know them. I mean, Justin's from Semi Precious Weapon. He's easily one of the biggest pop writers, I think, of our generation.
Yeah.
Do you approach that session differently?
Well, I was really nervous because they are such kind of legendary songwriters, and it's the kind of thing that, you know, on the first album, I can't imagine that we'd have been able to get in the room with them because they're so busy. And, like, you know, so I remember when I was in LA working with Greg Kurstin, because we worked together on the first album as well, and Greg Kirsten's like a huge Grammy, you know, has a million Grammys. He's a big deal already. So, they were trying to make the session work with Justin and Julia, and I remember, like, my label management, everyone was just like, just so focused on getting the session with Justin and Julia, like it was the most important thing ever, you know. So it was like a lot of pressure already, and it's like, oh my god, royalty coming into the room, like. And so I was quite nervous, but they're amazing. They just make you feel at ease straight away, and they just like want to chill, and they just want to do, you know, that's why they're so good at what they do, I think. It's like they make artists feel chill, and they're obviously very like incredibly talented, and like, so it was I think I learned so much working with them. So
do you enter those sessions with something, ideas ready, or do you come clean slate?
I think is always good.
Yeah,
it can be a bit scary to be totally clear. Some people don't like that. I know some songwriters, like, they need to have the ideas before they get in the room, which I totally understand, but we did a clean slate vibe.
Got it. Were you religious growing up?
No, I wasn't. But when I was 6 years old, I wasn't. Not, my family aren't religious or anything. But when I was 6 years old, my family moved to this little town in the countryside, and we moved next to a church. So me and my friends used to like play in the churchyard, and the school that we went to was like a Christian school. It was like so, and I had no idea what any of it was. Like I had no idea like Christianity was a thing until I was like 7, 8 years old, and I was really like blown away by it. So I think that's maybe part of why I'm quite fascinated by it.
Yeah, you read the Bible?
Never read it.
No.
I hear it's a good read.
Oh, it's quite a book. I read it when I was in middle school, and I forget 98% of it.
It's a book. Yeah.
I really think I pretended to read it just like to get by, but I hear there's moments in the book that are worth taking a look at.
Yeah, the Old Testament, great.
Yeah, right?
Great stuff.
I'm more of a New Testament girl, but that's fine.
Fair enough.
What exactly is Palos Santo? Is it Santo or Santo? How do you pronounce it?
I don't have the authority on how to pronounce it. I think it's however you want to.
Hold on. Okay. Are you saying you don't have the authority on how to pronounce it because we live...
Well...
You go.
Well, only because... because I say Palo Santo, but because really the album's called Palo Santo kind of because there's this fictional universe that we've created called Palo Santo. But so yeah, maybe I do have the authority.
Yeah, you made it up yourself.
Maybe yeah, it's Palo Santo. But it's also, you know, the name of like an actual stick of wood that you burn. So I like don't want to get that part wrong. Do you know what I mean?
Do you come up with the name and then realize that it's a stick of wood?
No, I encountered. I basically met this guy, and in his house he had this really nice smell, and I was like, what is that smell? And he was like, oh, it's Palo Santo. So I was like, what is that? And he showed me that it's sort of a little bit like sandalwood. It's like this little or incense, but it's a stick of wood, and you just burn one end of it, and the smoke smells really nice. And it's said to, traditionally, it's said to like cleanse your space of negative energy and evil spirits.
Got it.
So that's like, what that stuff is called.
I want some of that. Sounds good.
I think this album is going to totally change the Palo Santo stick industry. You're going to really set it on the right course.
Right.
But I question you not wanting to give an intense definition or the right pronunciation of Palo Santo, because it is a genderless universe where labels don't necessarily exist. That's what you've created.
Yeah, exactly.
Where does that come from? What you dream of, what you want to see happen, or is that just totally fiction and just pulled out of thin air?
Well, I think it's probably maybe it's a bit of both, but it's when I think of the world that Palo Santo is, the world that we wanted to create, that I wanted to create, I think where it came from, it's like stuff I've been, like you said, dreaming about, thinking about ever since I was a little kid. And also, you know, when I was thinking, like, even before we started to make any music, I knew I wanted to create this, like, fantasy world. And I think part of the reason was the real world kind of depresses me too much. And I wanted to... And I'm, yeah,
amen.
Right. And I thought, oh, well, pop music is, for me, like, my favorite thing about pop music is the fantasy and the escapism of it. So why don't we create our own world? And, you know, in this world, we don't have gender, we don't have sexuality. Like those, all those things are just completely kind of rewritten, or those rules are taken off the table because most of the people there are androids. So what is an android's gender? What's an android's sexuality? And I thought that was like a really interesting kind of thing to explore.
But can these androids feel?
Well, this is the whole point of the kind of this is what we're trying to kind of get into with the music videos and the we made a short film as well that's coming out with the album, because I think androids can feel, and I'm quite sympathetic to these androids, like, because these androids, they just want to be more human. And I thought it was an interesting, you know, we it's like a quite a good, I think for us as human beings, like I'm a human, it's good for us to kind of think about our own humanity sometimes, and like how precious that is. To be able to feel things is pretty cool.
But also not to take it for granted.
Not to take it for granted, exactly.
Because I do. A part of me feels like we're going to live in a world where robots do almost everything.
Yeah.
So it's only a certain point where they just totally overrule us and outsmart us every step of the way. Ultimately, hopefully, we control the plug, you know? But you never know. But I do think a genderless, you know, raceless society might eventually exist.
Right? I mean, it's possible.
I keep on thinking of Avatar when you're talking about this.
Yeah.
Totally. I mean, I'm not, yeah, exactly. Like, throughout time there's been, you know, stories like this, like we've imagined what the future might be like, and I'm just, you know, I'm kind of fascinated by it. I think it's going to get wild.
Are any of the songs on the album written based off this world you've created, or are they all for your real life?
They're all from my real life, really. Yeah, so the two, the music and the kind of, and this whole concept thing, you know, kind of, you know, independent of each other, but I really love putting them together because mm-hmm. it kind of gives it a different spin in a way, and it makes you kind of like, I don't know, I think it's kind of interesting, but they're pretty separate from each other in a way too.
What's been your biggest change that you've seen in yourself artistically between 2010 when you started and now?
I guess I had like no real conviction to follow through with my ideas, I think, or I'd always think what I think. I think I just had a lack of self-confidence, you know, and it's taken me a while to actually get to a place where I'd be like, I'm going to make this sci-fi space android like experience. Like, I could never have really, like, because I'll be honest with you, like, it's kind of out there, and like, a lot of people weren't expecting it. So I had to like really, really sell it to everybody. I had to be like, this is what we're doing. It's going to be amazing.
What was your sales pitch to them?
Well, I actually...
By the way, sophomore album, pressure exists, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Like, there was some like faking it till I make it vibes for sure. But I actually went into our label in the UK, Polydor, and gave like a presentation to them all. I did a PowerPoint presentation where I burnt Palo Santo wood and we like played music.
Nice.
And I gave them this whole presentation where I was like, look, this is what the concept is, this is what all the music videos are going to be, this is how the merchandise is going to look, this is how the artwork's going to be, like, what? Give me the money.
and they said
yes.
Nice. All right.
Yeah, we managed to like get it through. So
who's working with you on all of this? Or are you doing it all yourself?
No, I'm making it sound like I'm doing it myself, but a lot of it, you know, is me. But me and my manager Martha, who's actually sat over there.
Hello.
Hi, Martha.
Sorry, I thought she was Meghan Trainor. I couldn't tell. Oh, yeah.
She's kind of like she's sort of like another kind of co-parent of Palo Santo, and also a director who called Fred Rosen, who directed the videos for us. We were like emailing about a year ago and talking about, you know, how this is all going to work, and you know, I have all these crazy ideas, and he's actually responsible to like actually make them happen in a way that makes sense, that isn't just completely insane. So yeah, it wasn't, you know, just all me, and we had a like amazing choreographer, amazing stylist, just like a good bunch of creative people trying to find like artists, you know, who really just want to do something
different and special.
Yeah,
I'm, you know, I don't know if you are the luckiest dude in the world or the other two members of this band are the luckiest people in the world, because you singing in a shower turns into you really being the face and the voice and an incredible creative outlet for you for almost a decade now. And then the other two dudes get the, I think they're chilling right now.
I love that you're playing in the sofa and it's like, they're not here.
They can be chilling right now and they're kind of along for this ride that you've kind of laid out for them.
So they don't exist.
They're like, they're holograms.
Yeah.
They show up when it's time to play, but they still get paid.
Yeah. It's pretty sweet, right?
Yes. You're the one, you know, creatively racking your brain and doing all of this and pushing yourself.
Yeah, but I think, you know, that's like part of the sort of the last 18 months was because when we first started out making the second album, we had literally had no idea what we were going to do. And it was quite a struggle for a long time because we were just sort of going in loads of different directions, trying to make each other happy and then ending up with like not making anyone happy. And I basically said to them, look, I have this thing that I want to do, this crazy vision, and these are the songs, like I think we should do this. And they were like, yeah, okay, let's do that.
Whatever you want, Ollie.
Basically, like, yeah, I've become a monster.
Where does your sound come from? Because whenever I listen to your songs, they have like a jungly tribal sound.
Ooh.
That's how I feel when I listen to it.
I'm like that.
Where does he get this from?
Well, I mean, I guess you could say that we all have like a different musical taste within the group, but we all share a love of kind of like R&B and dance music. And I think where that kind of like crosses over on like a pop mm-hmm. sphere is like, I think where we try and like aim all the music. But in terms of like the jungly tribal vibes, I think that's just like rhythm. You know, we're always like trying to get rhythm, like polyrhythms, like interesting rhythms, interesting beats that you know, like aren't the expected kind. But I like that.
Because like if I'm listening to like If You're Over Me, I feel like I'm walking around in like a happy jungle.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, nice.
Like leaves and butterflies. I'm like, oh, look at me. Here we are.
I'm feeling like a Disney, like Jungle
exactly.
Book.
Exactly. Yeah.
The animals are going to start talking to you.
Yeah. Yeah, like, oh, hey, hippo.
Oh, wow. I would love to be in that happy jungle. But yeah, I mean, that's like a, you know, this is, I think it's probably just a syncopated rhythm, you know, and like there's a lot of rhythms going on in that song. Mm-hmm.
Are the other two in the room when you're creating?
Or yeah, I mean, it depends on the song, because If You're Over Me was like a really quite a different song for us, that in the way that it came about, because I wrote it with this guy called Steve Mack, and we just did it in like an afternoon, and he already had that do-do-do-do-do-do-do, where he was like, what about this? Do-do-do-do-do. And I was like, that's interesting. I've never heard that before, you know. So I just wrote the top line to it, and it was done in like 2 hours. And then Mikey and Emery added production to the song, and like Mikey added his bass line and everything. So that one happened a little bit differently. So, but then some of the songs, yeah, we're all in the room together when we're creating it. So it depends.
Does this album top to bottom tell a story, or are each song individuals? I mean, they are individuals, but are they a part of something bigger?
I'm just thinking, if they are part of something bigger, I guess it would just be like, say you were to get like my diary and like you were just looking through the entries of, you know, September 2016 to, I don't know, February 2018, then this would be this album would be it.
Your personal diary.
That's it. Yeah.
How good do you feel after you get a song done and you get it off your chest?
It's the best. So yeah, it's such a relief.
Is it built like, do you have notes? Do you keep like voice notes? What do you do? How do you track your thoughts?
I keep voice notes, yeah. And I make like little notes, and I keep a diary as well. So
cute.
Yeah.
It's like voice protected. Is there like a locket around it?
Yeah. Oh my God. I did have a diary like that when I was a teenager, like one that had a little lock. Oh, and nice. Everyone used to make fun of me because it was like only girls had those diaries.
Whatever.
And I was like, smash the gender binary.
Exactly.
General society, real early.
Exactly, real early.
They don't get it. They're laughing now.
Exactly.
Truly. I mean, this is cool. Palo Santo, you have a universe here.
Can you tell me about All For You? When that chorus kicks in, whew, that's a good one.
You like it?
Yeah, I really do.
Oh, thank you.
What's that song about? It's just like a happy, makes you want to dance.
Yeah. Well, that song is, I wanted to have like a really up, I mean, like something that was really upbeat and mm-hmm. that you could dance to, but actually had this quite like, I don't know, like, because the song is really about reflecting on a relationship and kind of being like, actually you were more in this for you, like all those things you did and like the things you said to me and the way you treated me, like now that I think about it, it says more about you than it does about me. Mm-hmm. And like there's quite like a bite to the lyrics in that way, that's kind of like a little sting. So but I kind of liked how it was sort of like coated in this like sugary pop song.
That's a hard realization to come to after you leave a relationship.
It's also like not the nicest one, because I like want to accept that people are good and bad, we all have flaws, we're not perfect, you know, like but like that doesn't always like make the best pop song.
Right. Sometimes you can be a little nasty, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly, you gotta be a little petty.
Yeah,
I'm just soaking all of this in, man, like hypnotized. Good record too. Like what is the story behind that, and what is that even right off the name? Like,
well, that song in particular is unusual because it came about because of Baz Luhrmann, the director.
Yes.
Asked if we would make something for him because he was making an advert, and he like this crazy huge advert, and he was like, oh, I'd love to use a Years and Years song. So we sent him some of our new songs, and he was like, oh, none of these quite work. And I was like, I'll just make you one, like what do you want? And he told me what he was kind of thinking, and he got so involved, like he's so passionate about music, Baz.
He loves it.
And I was had this kind this song that was sort of brewing about being like falling in love with someone, in that moment of falling in love with someone where you're completely like bowled over and you're just completely blinded by the other person, like hypnotized, because that was something that I wasn't experiencing at the time. And I was like, I wonder if I'll ever fall in love again. So I kind of wrote that song for Baz, really, and for kind of like my hopeful romantic self inside or something. So yeah, that's how it came about.
I am so sorry to interrupt the interview. I'll just be real quick. Get Quip. It's the best toothbrush out there. I'm obsessed with this thing. It sticks right to my mirror. It's timed out perfectly, so I always know that I'm brushing the right amount. They send me refill heads like every month, and that's not just for convenience, it's for my health. Plus, Quip is an amazing toothbrush. It's electric, and it starts at only $25. $25 for really the best toothbrush you will ever buy. I got it for Dan, Heather, my mom, my sister, my dad. Oprah uses this toothbrush, so why shouldn't you? Quip, seriously, it's the best. Go to getquip.com/sang, and you're going to get a toothbrush starting at $25, and your free refill pack will follow. That's right, you'll get something free if you go to getquip.com/sang. Try out the Quip toothbrush, you'll love it, but I really want you to tell me what you think. So use it and get back to me. Getquip.com/sang. Okay, back to the interview. What do you learn about yourself from making this album?
One thing I learned was that, like, I thought I have like a lot of unresolved anger issues.
As you laugh about it.
Yeah.
So funny.
I was holding on to some like anger basically just over previous relationships and like even my dad, like even stuff from my childhood. I was like, wow, I'm actually angry about some stuff that I didn't realize, you know? So that's one thing I learned. And
Do you fix your anger after you realize that you're angry? Do you make amends with people, or once it's in a song, you're okay and you don't need to talk to them again?
Well, oh God, I don't know actually, because now that I think about it, I'm not sure I have dealt with this in a great way because I just wrote songs about it. But
like, have you told your dad that you're angry about whatever?
I mean, kind of. I think he knows, but I mean, we don't really have a relationship, so it's like it would be weird for me to just call him up and tell him right now. But you know what I mean. But
is it ever weird to call your dad, no matter the situation?
Is it what? Is it ever weird?
Yeah, I mean, it could be.
It's always weird.
it's always weird.
I get it. I get it. But if it's on you, you should at least send them the record.
That's true. Well, I mean, it's online. It's not hard to find.
Yeah. He'll find it. He knows what you're up to. He'll find it.
Does he have Spotify? Look it up.
I'm about to get real mad, real angry. Just kidding.
Okay, yeah. So you don't necessarily make amends, but you just get it out of your system?
Yeah. I think, like, I don't know, sometimes, you know when you write a really long letter to somebody but you don't send it, or you write an email but you don't send it?
Yeah.
Like, you're just getting it all out, you know? Because sometimes you just need to get it out.
Yeah, but your out is out, like...
I know, it's really out.
Yeah. I sit on emails that I'll never send.
Yeah.
No one will see that, hopefully.
But I never say, like, specifics, you know? So, like, you know, so there are some people out there who probably, like, feel a little bit nervous that I've written a song about them, but they don't really know. Like, tell them
there's a possibility.
How about this lyric?
It's the mystique.
Do I look good in this position, just like him?
Yeah. What about it?
I don't know. What about it?
What do you want to know?
Sounds pretty literal to me. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, not hiding much there.
It's kind of self-explanatory, right? Yeah.
Do those people, or does he know it's about him?
I don't know. I don't know. I don't think so. And to be honest, like, I've been around the block a few times, so I've managed to, like, kind of spread the...
There's so many people.
Yeah, exactly.
It could be anybody.
Anybody could be the father.
They'd be like, oh, yeah, you know, Ollie? Yeah, me too. Ha, you know, so, yeah, it's that vibe.
That is...
Nice.
I like that vibe.
Are you thinking that lyric while you're hooking up with this person?
Oh, what? No. No. I mean, what?
In the middle of...
No.
Here's a lyric.
Well, but even afterwards, do you come off that moment and you're like, well, just... I wonder if he's comparing me to the last person.
I mean, kind of, yeah. But that's like a real... That's like a... Whew, I don't know if I...
I'm sweating.
Yeah, I'm swaying a little bit.
Relax.
I'm relaxed. Relax.
Yeah, everybody be cool. We're all adults here, okay?
Yeah.
I won't get an answer. That's okay.
No, what was the question? Like, do I...
No, but I don't think there was one.
There was no question.
Well, I have a question. How was it performing, dancing, singing while Rihanna's staring at you?
Oh, my goodness. I don't know. I feel like my life was just leading up to that point.
You're born to do that?
Yeah. Like, wow, it's so cool to be achieving my life goal right now. yeah. Do you know what, though? She was just like so... She was everything you'd want her to be and more in that moment. She was just like... She's so chilled and just like... I don't know. She has this energy about her, which is like very warm and like friendly, and you just want to be in her presence, and like she's just glowing and like, you know, like light filled magical goddess.
You know who wasn't chill afterwards?
Me.
You.
Yeah. You. I'm not a goddess.
You were on Graham Norton and you wanted to give everyone a hug, and there was all eight of them. You're like, hello, hello, hello.
Yeah, they were like, Ollie, don't hug them when you go on. They were like, we don't have the time, like, don't hug them. But as if you could not hug those.
There's the whole cast of Ocean's 8.
Yeah. Like, what, I'm just supposed to walk up onto the... So people that aren't familiar with the show, basically, they have, like, you know, a couch full of celebrities. And at the end, the musical guest comes on to be like, hey, I'm a musician, buy my album. and that's basically what I did. But obviously, the couch is full of, like, Sandra Bullock, Kate Blanchett, mm-hmm. Sarah Paulson, Helena Bonham Carter, and Rihanna.
That's crazy.
So literally, I was just, like, trying not to faint, basically. Yeah, it was a big moment.
And then she got an early copy of the...
She got the first copy of Palo Santo. Yeah, she did.
How do you hand deliver that to her?
Yeah. I gave it to her. Yeah, I was like, I wrote on it, bad gal Riri, I love you.
Whoa.
And then I gave it to her. And I was like, you can throw it away if you want to. She was like, I would never do that. And then she hugged me.
Do you think she's listened? Do you even want to know?
I guess, let's go with yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. I mean, she probably hasn't. No. But she might have.
Hey, you don't know. Hopefully yeah. She reaches, you know, maybe she'll reach out.
Listen, my DMs are open for Rihanna.
Always. I think you guys would be good together. She has like a jungly tribal vibe too.
Well, I mean, I would do like anything. She did a song with Mickey Echo and Coldplay, so.
Why not you?
Why not me?
If
why not me, Rihanna?
Let's say the album leaked and you found out it was Rihanna who leaked it. What would you do?
I would thank her.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for ruining my career. Yeah.
Didn't Katy Perry get an early release too?
She did, yeah. She got the second like copy, which she was annoyed about. She was like, how dare you? What is this? You're just giving copies of your album to pop stars.
But only the biggest pop stars.
That's what I mean. I was like, come on, Katy Perry, it's just literally just you and Rihanna, like I love you.
This is an elite group. How Katy Perry? Do you just see her and you just happen to have an album ready to go?
I mean, we went to see her show. Okay. Yeah, she played in Birmingham. And so we took one with us. Yeah. Her show was amazing.
It's sick.
It was so cool. Yeah.
It's a crazy production.
It was, like, blew my mind.
Are you working on this tour for this album?
Yes.
All you? Engulfed in it?
I mean, I've been trying. So the first time we had a production meeting for this tour, I was like, okay, I want to be in a giant tree. And then I want to come down in a swing inside the moon. Like, how can we make this happen?
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
So we've, like, done our version of that. But it's really exciting because we've got a brand new show. Got this amazing, like, stage that we've designed. And I get, at one stage, I do actually get lifted up in this sort of, like, giant flowing robe. And then there is a big moon behind me.
Wow. That's
and we have dancers and it's all singing, all dancing, like amazing crazy costumes, and it's I wanted to bring the Palo Santo experience on the road, so
majestic.
Yeah, majestic. Yeah, hopefully.
Do you bring the other two out for the shows, or is it just you in a robe hanging from, like, swinging?
Yeah, it's just me in the spotlight.
They're in the dark on the sides.
Yeah. Actually, Mikey has. So Mikey is a magician in the If You're Over Me video, and he's really taken to this role, like, as this sort of, like, magic. Because I also like gave Mikey and Emmy roles. I was like, Mikey, you're going to be a magician, and they didn't really have much choice in the matter. And Emery was always going to be this news presenter, like, in Palo Santo, which he absolutely kills. So I'm a good casting director, but and Mikey comes on stage and he has this, like, you know, a lot of blue face paint, makeup, and like a sparkly outfit. And he has this giant keytar. Do you know what a keytar is?
Do I know a keytar?
I don't.
It's like a guitar, but with keys. It's piano and guitar combined.
A keytar. Okay, yeah, I get it.
And it's like a Palo Santo keytar. So it's like this weird, giant, kind of like red, strange, like, symbol that's made into a keytar. And he stands at the top of the stairs and does this, like, keytar solo. So, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on.
They have their place.
They do, yeah.
I wanted to ask him, like, how do they feel about you being the front man? Like, how do they feel about you being their front man?
I think they're relieved, to be honest.
They, a lot less work for them, I would think.
Yeah. I mean, I think they never really wanted to, like, be... I think you have to be a specific kind of person to, like, want to be a front person.
Yeah.
And, like, I don't know. It, you know, it's good and has good points, has bad points. It's either, like, something you really want. You know, for me, I've always wanted to be this, do this since I was, a kid. And if you don't, if that's not something you wanted to do, then, like, that's, it's just not, isn't it? It's just not something you're...
meant to do, meant to be. Not everybody wants to, you know, come down from a tree on a swing in a flowing robe attached to a moon.
I know.
Which is a shame.
They?
Yeah.
Or do
that
they
sounds
actually?
Awesome. Yeah. I never thought I wanted to, but now I do.
Maybe we all do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you get to do it.
Yeah, I know. That's, it's quite ridiculous. Yeah. I can't believe I've gotten away with it, to be honest.
But, like, have you had moments throughout this journey where you're just like, holy like, what is my life? Like, look what I get to do. Like, look at my form of therapy. It's getting to create music and create albums and go on tour. Like,
yeah,
pretty nuts.
All the time. I'm mostly, though, I think, like, obviously I am a part, I'm, like, a very important part of this. Like, as in, I've, you know, it's come from my brain and everything, and I'm, like, the singer and I write the music, blah, blah, blah. But when it's happening, it feels like you're part of something that's, like, bigger than yourself, you know? Like, because... the whole reason, like, we get to do it is because of, obviously, the fans that support us in the first place and come to the shows and give me the confidence for me to be who I am, to give them a good show and to give them the good music. And then, you know, it's always also involved with, like, a huge team of people who are putting their everything into making this project work and making it the best it can be. So it just feels like you're part of this, like, very colourful, magical, like, train that's just, like, hurtling towards the destination. You're like, wow, this is crazy. I can't believe I'm on this journey. Like, what's going on? Like, I can't look left or right or else I'll fall off. So let's keep going, you know? So it's wild, but it's special, you know?
But that is music and art. Like, your music will be here long after you, you know? And who knows what that could do for people 100 years from now.
Unless... because everything's digital and, like, there's some sort of, like, weird digital warfare and everything becomes corrupted and then we won't have anything because we don't have physical copies anymore.
It's true.
Right?
Rihanna has that one album.
Rihanna Katy's got two. There's two out there.
Let's start burning CDs.
I want to be in the bunker with Rihanna and Katy Perry.
That's the best bunker to be in. And you know, there could be some Illuminati or some, like, bigger government culture bunker where those people just get taken in and they have, like,
so true,
luxury accommodations to keep culture going after society is all gone.
Oh, I really hope that... I mean, do I hope that exists? Well, kind of, yeah.
Yeah, because you want to get there.
I want to get there.
Work hard enough to get in Katy Perry and Rihanna's bunker.
Yeah, exactly.
The world goes to crap.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, my God.
Are you open to love right now? Are you looking for somebody?
Am I looking for somebody? I don't know. I would... basically, no. But now, because I've been single for, like, almost 2 years, and now I'm thinking, like, maybe it's time. Maybe, I don't know. Because the longer you're single, the more you're like, how is anyone ever in a relationship?
Exactly.
Like, that just seems like way too much work.
Is this the longest you've been single in a while?
Yeah.
What do you learn about yourself from being single?
Well, I really like my independence. I really like being by myself and doing shit for myself. And I don't have a lot of time for, like, other people shit right now. So that's another thing. I also think, I don't know, I wanted to go away by myself, so I went traveling, well, I went, like, on a little break by myself, and I realized I wanted to be single because I wanted to go away by myself, you know, I wanted to travel alone and, like, figure some stuff out, so I'm glad I did that. Also, I just think, like, you notice how many people are in relationships as well, and you're like, oh, because, you know, so a lot of people in relationships are actually, personally, I think, it's more because it's convenient for them and they're kind of, like, relying on each other. And so I'm just out here looking at them being like, okay, like, no, I'm just judging your relationship. Because I'm a bitter single person who's, like, heart is frozen over.
Wow.
Is that what you figure out about yourself when you go on this trip alone? That you have a cold heart?
Just cold, dead heart.
Just blackness on the inside.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
I did... fascinating, because when you're single and you look at other people, you do realize, like, are they doing this out of convenience or are they doing this out of happiness? And, like, you don't really need to be in a relationship for convenience.
No, and also, you know, like, some of the loneliest people are in relationships as well.
That's so deep.
Right?
And sad.
Deep and sad.
Anyway. They're in the wrong relationship, are they not? You should not be lonely if you're giving your time, energy, and focus to somebody. And it doesn't need to be giving 100% of it. Like, even if you're giving, you know, 20% of it.
I mean, I don't... Yeah, it doesn't sound great, does it?
No.
It's definitely not. We're going to say it's a negative. Yeah.
I don't want that for anybody.
Yeah.
I want people to have their best fulfilled lives. But, you know, everyone has... there's so many different ways to have a relationship, you know? And we all have this, like, one model where it's like we have to be best friends, like, completely... you know, like in each other's lives all the time, doing everything together. Like, we're emotional rocks. We have amazing sex. We're like, do you know what I mean? It's
yeah,
like no one can
it.
Really fulfill like that entire, you know, it's just, it's a lot.
The definition and standard that we put around a relationship and making it kind of one, there's like a singular meaning to it.
I think, and it's always like, are you happy? Are you guys happy? Are you happy? And it's like, it's not always about being happy all the time, you know? Just chill.
Calm down.
Chill out. I'm fine.
Another thing in the future, you know, a different definition for what a relationship is.
This is what I'm saying. I'm saying I'm just like, I'm trying to visualize this thruple that I'm going to be a part of. And it's basically going to be me living next door to like a really hot, older gay couple, really good at cooking. They have a really sick house by the ocean. And I'll just... Basically, have you seen Grace and Frankie?
Yes.
What I'm aiming for my life to be like.
So they feed you and take care of you and you tap in when it's time to reciprocate.
Yeah.
But you don't
cook
clean or provide any money to the situation.
Well, I mean...
But maybe... You're rich. You can do the finances.
I mean, I don't know. I provide... I feel like... My presence is a gift.
More than enough.
You're gawky. I like that.
I have a question. Were you supposed to be doing something for Interview Magazine with Troye Sivan?
Yes.
What happened to that? Well, what happened to those pictures
I have
you posted?
No idea. I have no idea. And I deleted them because I got into trouble. So.
Did you release them too soon?
Yeah, it was a whole thing. I don't know. Like... I'm not allowed to, maybe I'll get like in trouble if I even speak about it now.
I don't want you to get in trouble.
Well, we know because you put it on the internet.
Yeah, obviously I made a mistake by doing that, but thanks for bringing it up to me now. I appreciate
You're
that.
You're welcome.
Did you actually interview each other?
Yeah.
So that's done?
Yes, yeah. It's out there somewhere.
I've been looking the whole time you've been talking and I can't find it anywhere.
Yeah, well I think it's like maybe like on a laptop.
Oh, and not mine. It's on a private laptop.
Right.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So I have no idea.
One day, maybe.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was a cool photo shoot.
Thanks. I thought so.
What are you doing? Are you living in the UK full time? Are you coming back and forth between here and LA or there in LA?
I'm living in London. Yeah. That's kind of like, but I don't know. It feels like you don't really live anywhere when you're on tour because you're just, you know, around the world all the time. But I don't know. I'm thinking like I could maybe. Do a little California moment.
A moment.
At some point.
Like, like, are we talking about like months? Are we going to buy a place? Are we going to rent a place? How permanent do you
want?
Do you?
What should I do?
I don't know.
I'm repping the shirt right now, so.
Yeah. I'm no financial advisor, so I don't. But you can, you know. It's a good rental market. It's expensive.
I
want to buy if you can.
Okay. Well.
Great.
There
that's
go.
All I know.
Yeah, thank you.
Take that advice.
Where do you live?
Oh, I live in West Hollywood.
Oh, well, that's nice, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a great area.
Do you go out in West Hollywood?
Oh, yeah.
Where do you go?
Bars? You heard of the Abbey? Or
yes,
like,
yes, of course.
Yeah, Chapel, Bar 10.
I walked past a place called Jim the other day.
Oh, yeah.
That's opposite of Jim.
Yeah.
But Jim is a bar. Called Jim.
Yes.
Like Jim, like
JYM.
And the
It's like a gay bar that plays, it's like a gay sports bar.
Right.
That's exactly what it is.
Oh, that sounds fun.
It's a gay sports bar.
And it gets really crowded and the drinks are really strong and everybody there is like really sweaty.
You sound like you're repulsed by it, but it sounds awesome.
No, it's a good time. That's, you know.
It's quite intimidating. I walked past and I was a little intimidated.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. A lot of like extreme pectorals, which I am a fan of. But like a lot also, which if you're just not, you know, as pectorally inclined as I might be.
Fair enough.
There's a lot to see walking around West Hollywood.
There is. I love walking around West Hollywood for that reason.
A lot of eye candy.
A lot of eye candy.
Maybe an opportunity for you to form a relationship.
I know.
Not with any depth. You
exactly. I like how that's what you think would be appropriate for me.
I mean, I based on your cold heart, I'm just trying to...
You're completely correct. Yes, that's what I'm looking for. So if you see me later on walking around West Hollywood...
Well, say hi.
Making eyes, say hi. Don't engage with any emotional kind of intensity.
Just, this is a pure business transaction. Nothing more, nothing less.
Yeah, exactly.
West Hollywood's the place to get that done, by the way.
Yeah. What do you do? Like, who do you hang out with?
Are you looking for friends right now? Like, what's going on?
If I'm going to move here, then maybe. Will you guys be my friends?
Yeah.
But where do you all live?
I live in West Hollywood.
He doesn't leave his house, though.
Why not?
I don't like to go out. I actually go to the actual gym and then my house, which I actually pass the gym on the way there. Ugh. So I'll look for you.
I mean,
he won't talk to you.
We can make eye contact.
Yeah, just a little wave.
But no words.
I have some friends.
Who are your friends? Do you have any famous friends?
Let me pull up the list.
I feel like you have famous friends.
I mean, yeah. I mean,
like who? Who's your most famous friend?
There's a list. I mean, small. It's not a big list, but like, there's a few quality candidates or quality people and
like who?
Good
he
artists.
He likes to hang out with Ariana Grande,
Meghan Trainor.
Oh, okay.
AJR hangs out with a lot.
That's kind of A-list. So like, these are A-list.
Look,
A-list.
It's no Rihanna and Katy Perry.
No,
that's true.
I mean, Ariana maybe, but
I don't give my work to them.
No,
you know, I don't hand my CD of my radio show to Meghan Trainor.
It's a little different.
Yeah, it is a little different.
So you're saying that's not the way to start a friendship?
No, but I think your music can really build that bond.
Oh,
you planted a seed that has the opportunity to grow.
I think so. Yeah. So next time we hang out, next time when we see each other, me and Rihanna, she'll remember me. I hope.
That's all you want is a memorable moment for the next time.
Yeah.
And that there's going to be a next time.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I'm sorry for like questioning you about your friends and your social life. I feel weird about that. But I just felt very comfortable for a minute and I was like, maybe we'll be friends when I live here.
No, first of all, we can totally
be
friends.
I'll be hanging out with you and Ariana Grande. Ariana, in fact.
You can. You don't even need to be there.
You can introduce us and then leave.
I'm starting to get that cold heart is giving me a chill right now.
It's funny.
But it probably end up happening and that's
kidding.
Okay.
No, it's not. I care about you more.
Thanks.
For now.
In this moment.
Yeah, right,
because you're
right
in the room.
Now. Yeah. No, but for real, we can hang. I would love to hang.
Okay.
I saw you on a dating app.
Really?
Yeah. I swiped right. You didn't swipe left. Or you probably swiped left and not right.
What dating app?
Sick bird.
I know which dating app.
Yeah.
Raya.
On Raya? Mm-hmm. I've never seen you on that. Also, okay. Are we allowed to even talk about this? Because isn't it meant to be like secret?
Yeah, but then they opened the floodgates to other people, and I thought from that moment on, it was like, it's fair game.
I'll be honest, I have a Raya profile, but it's on hidden. So you might have, but it wasn't hidden always. But now I just use it to see if like who else is on it, because you know you can set it to see like men and women, like any orientation, whatever age. So I set it to everybody, and then I just sort of like go through and see and try and find the most famous people.
Literally, what I did.
Yeah, exactly.
I haven't touched it since.
Yeah, that's all I do on it.
There's some good people on there.
There are some pretty good people. Yeah, some like legit famous people.
Not bad.
I saw Nick Jonas on there once.
Demi Lovato.
Ooh. Yeah. But now Nick Jonas is maybe engaged.
About to be. Priyanka Chopra.
Yeah. Love her.
You see that love. You see Ariana getting engaged. You see Nick Jonas possibly getting engaged. Technically, he put a promise ring on her finger. You know?
Ooh.
It's like 2007 all over again.
Right.
They love the promise ring. You get no inclination or no bug to like find the person and maybe settle down?
I mean, I don't know. What does that mean, settling down? Like, what do I have to do?
Wife and kids. Little dog and a picket fence.
I mean, I probably won't get a wife.
Husband and kids.
I think you're...
I don't know. I think maybe I'm, like, not very, like, normal.
You want to settle down with two gay dudes living next door to you who feed you and...
Yeah, with animals. And probably, like, no kids.
No,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, you don't like kids?
I mean, I know I really like kids. I don't know. It depends. God, I'm under pressure now.
It depends on the kid.
It depends on who it is. Like,
depends on the kid.
Depends on the kid.
You get a real asshole kid.
Yeah.
Nobody likes an asshole.
No. It would be too much. I feel like I don't know. I just, yeah. I couldn't deal with that right now.
Let's focus on a genderless society and let's focus on you getting a house. either here or next to a gay couple in
yes,
London.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes. That's, thank you. Those achievable goals, I think.
Let's stay in reality.
Yeah.
Palo Santo, that is the album. Yes. July 6th, it is out.
Sorry, I forgot we were even like talking about an album. But we are. Let's get back to it. July 6th.
I'm very excited to hear the entire album.
It's really good.
I would say like bring us a hard copy, but I don't think I have a CD player.
No, I don't think we even have a CD of it. So, no, I'm sure we probably do.
Send me the files. I'll burn one.
Yeah, we'll send you the files. Yeah.
Send us a record, some autograph
we'll send
records.
You a Dropbox or an autograph. Or that.
Yeah, I'll take
whatever you want.
Okay.
It's an album. Technically, a record is a song.
Yeah, no, he gave actual records, like records, like record records.
Oh, you gave like vinyls?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, I never understand that, how some people say record as in.
Wait, you gave a Rihanna a vinyl?
Yeah.
How, do you think she walks around with a vinyl player on her?
Of course
you said,
not.
You said a vinyl player?
Whatever, record player?
Yeah, no, of course not. That's why when you ask me, do you think she's listened to it? I'm like, well, probably not. Like, as if she's going to just like go sit down and with her LP player and put on the vinyl. But maybe she did.
Here's what
she
Interscope should do. They should send her a record player to play it on it.
Yes.
Yeah.
They should.
Hmm.
I feel like Rihanna might have a record player.
Yeah,
she's cool.
Does.
Yeah, but she's always on the go. I feel like she's a woman in motion.
She has a house, mm-hmm. I'm assuming. She lives somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Let's stop dreaming about Rihanna.
Anyway.
Okay. We've covered a lot.
Yeah.
We've gone over a lot of ground.
Too much, if you ask me.
Yeah.
No one asked. So.
I mean, it's all been filmed, so.
I think it was just enough.
It was just enough.
Holly Alexander, years and years.
Yes.
2 years later. Hopefully, we don't need to wait 2 years before we see you again.
Right?
You know, come back sooner.
We need to have a bigger, we need to have a career in America. I mean, we do, but.
I really, you're coming off of an incredibly strong album, really incredible singles, and what you have here in this era of your music, it's really special. And dude, the way you match pop and like the basic, I don't want to say basic, how infectious the songs are, and they are surface level to an extent, but there's so much depth to every lyric. I don't know, man. I think you have something special here, and it's going to really resonate with people. So
I hope so. Well, thank you for having me back, honestly.
Of course.
I really do actually love you guys, and I was excited to come back. So thanks for having me.
We like having you here.
Even if you grill me a little bit, but it's okay.
We'll have more questions for next time, don't worry.
Yeah, exactly.
I appreciate you deeply, and hopefully the next time we're hanging out socially, you can come over to my house in West Hollywood.
Yes. See, yes. That's how, okay, good. This is going
to
happen.
No, yeah. Nobody here wants to come and hang out with me.
Oh, why not?
I don't go out. I don't do anything.
Dan has never been to my house. Heather's been to my house a couple times.
Yeah, you know.
What do you think, Heather?
About his house?
Marks out of 10. For the decor inside.
Oh, it's all right. It's weird. His roommate's weird.
Whoa.
She has all the dead stuff.
Yeah, but we have a beautiful house.
No, you have a very nice house, yeah. It's just a lot of like weird like there's taxidermied animals.
Okay, yeah, there's a couple dead animals, but they're kept in another room.
It's like a couple dead animals. That's a weird thing to say.
Do you have a pool?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
On the roof.
The view is really nice. You should go for the view.
Ooh.
Yeah. Don't come for me. Come for Ariana in my view.
Yeah, go for the view.
I want to expect when I'm coming over. I'm expecting Ariana Grande on the rooftop.
Wow. She'll just be laid out ready, just
by the pool,
hanging, sipping something. Yeah.
I can't wait. I can't wait for that.
You've set your expectations so high.
Yeah.
I'll probably not deliver. Ollie, years and years.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
I really hope you enjoyed that conversation. If you did, please subscribe and also check out our podcast. There's a link in the description, and also comment and like and do things. Other interviews are on the screen somewhere, so click them. Thanks for watching.